just got weird. When you cut it off, that's when it got weird.
Oh, be careful with your things, because the sound will pop that. Okay, it'll pop that. Mm, that sounds like a rat beat or something, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Okay, I got to turn the intro off. Throw it away. Thank you for coming by, Chad. Thank you for coming by and checking out the channel today. Today with us, we have my friend Jason Sims. Jason, thanks for coming over today.
Oh, yeah. Thank you for having me and giving me some of this delightful sweet tea.
That's what we do it. That's what we do it in the South.
That's what I came for, was the sweet tea. When this tea is over, I'm gone. When this tea's empty, out of here.
Tell us a little bit about yourself.
I am Jason Sims, as you said. I describe myself as a media dilettante, which means I like to play around with a lot of different sort of creative things, and unfortunately don't spend enough time doing any one of them to become really good at any of them. sort of like a bird kicks around in garbage, I guess. I'm married, have two children who are grown men now and shave. That makes me feel old. I'm growing a beard back. And this probably looks disgusting, but it's on its way.
I think it looks awesome.
Well, good. And
it's better than the alternative, and I think your wife would agree with me.
Yes, yeah. And I do a podcast, because it's the law that you do a podcast. And I'm
going to jail.
Yeah, and this counts. This counts.
Oh, okay.
And I do improv on a stage.
With
Comic Science Improv, the finest improvisers in North Alabama.
That's fantastic. So we're going to talk about some of that stuff. Let's talk about where you said you were born and raised here in Huntsville, or no?
I didn't say any such thing.
Well, tell us where you're from.
That's very convincing, you saying that like you don't know. I was actually born, my mother's doctor was in Haleyville, so I was born in Haleyville. Which is, I have to say that. I can't say I was born in Coleman. I was born in Haleyville Hospital. And then I was immediately taken to Coleman after they got done with me at the hospital. And I spent the rest of my days until about 17 or so in Coleman. Well, longer, actually. I was there a long time. So I was in Coleman a long time. That's where I'm from. Coleman, Alabama, which is just sort of like if you were to take North Alabama and throw a dart at it, about the middle would probably be Coleman. So I'm as much in North Alabama as you could possibly be. You could not be more in North Alabama than to be in Coleman.
So you actually now also work a day job as well,
I do work
correct?
A day job.
Outside
as well.
Of being creative.
Yes, where I'm not allowed to be creative. No, I have worked for a company that sells appliance parts for more years than I would have guessed that I would work for a company.
We won't tell anybody how many.
Yeah, a lot. And I've done various things. The longest thing that I did there was do accounts payable, and then it nearly drove me insane. So then I moved from there into a call center where I deal with customers, which I enjoy a lot more. So I help customers, both commercial customers who are, service guys and parts people and normal citizens meet their appliance parts needs.
Cool.
Yeah.
So how did you get started doing improv?
Well, as most people in America who are not in a major city probably discovered improv, I probably discovered it through watching Whose Line Is It Anyway. And I think I may have discovered it by seeing the British Whose Line. They used to show that on Comedy Central. And I just thought that was great because it took kind of being a crazy person, and it put it in a box.
Finally, where
it
became a
skill. Where it became a skill. It's not just that you're a crazy person. No, this is a skill, and people will applaud for you to be crazy. So it was always something I kind of wanted to do, and any time that I had a chance to do it, sort of informally, I would. And so when we moved to Huntsville, a little while after we moved to Huntsville. We were probably living in Madison, which for all practical purposes is Huntsville. I mean, it's the suburb of Huntsville. My friend Trevor Britton, our mutual friend, everyone in Huntsville's mutual friend, Trevor Britton.
Yes, he's a connection to Huntsville.
He's a hub.
He's a connector.
He's a social hub. He joined this troupe called Face to Face Improv, and he said some really nice things about it. That it was just a great environment, it was a much better environment than I would suspect that it would be. So he was doing that, so I would come and watch him in shows. So I watched that for a little while, and then I tried out at some point. I asked if I could try out, and I came to rehearsal, and never left until that troupe ended. And then that troupe ended, and it's really, I mean, really with the improv, I feel like it is, I don't feel like I'm very, like most things in life, I'm not very good at. Very many practical things I'm not good at all. One of the few things I feel like I am good at, and when I do it, I feel like I have done it well, is improvising. So I'm very, very thankful I've had the opportunity to do it. Now, an audience's experience of watching me improvise may be different, but when I finish doing it, I really feel like I have done a thing that I was made to do, if that's not overstating it.
But I think most people that improvise probably feel that way. Tell people all the time, for myself, in the acting world, I've done a lot of different things in front of the camera and behind the camera. I've done theater and stage and all these things, mm-hmm. but never did I feel at home more than I did when I did improv. That I just mm-hmm. felt like when I was doing that, it fit me. So do you feel that way about that?
Yeah, and I think a lot about improv, and I think a lot about, and one thing I've recently thought about with it that makes it different from other things is, more than any other creative thing I've done, improv is play. There's just this sense of play. Even though there is discipline to it and there's work to it, and we did a show last night, and Comic Science Improv, which is the troupe that started after Face to Face, by mostly Face to Face people. But since, new people who had never done improv before have come in and done amazing things there. Also, you could see David Hitt's interview that you did with him earlier.
Thank you.
He will cover more of that. anyhow, so we did a show last night, and our shows are very fast-paced. Like, we did an hour show, we did 18 games in an hour.
Wow, that's a lot.
In a small room, and it got hotter by the second. Excuse me. And we're very physical. A lot of movement. And I was extremely tired. I was exhausted. But it's still, like, compared to other things, like compared to writing is like, feels like I'm working with a pickaxe. You know, it really does. It feels like I'm...
Work. It feels like work.
But improv is kind of play. Like, improv is similar to the part of writing where you go, oh, I have an idea for a story. And, hey, this could have this kind of character in it. And they could do this. And they could do that. It's like all this potential. But then when you go and you try to actually make that potential fit on a page in a form that another human can come along and look at it and understand it without you there telling them about it, that's hard. But improv feels like the first part of that, even the performance aspect of it. So improv is the only art form that I can think of that the audience experiences it the exact same time that the artist does. That the artist, the creator, and the audience are both experiencing that thing for the first time. And I don't think anything else is like that.
Successful, there's nothing more beautiful.
Oh, it's just beautiful. Yeah, it's beautiful. And when it's awful, it's awful. Because it's awful. But still, I mean, you get some leeway. Because mm-hmm. they know, I mean, there are things, you know, that if you had written that to go that way, you'd be like, oh, this person hates himself. this person hates fun and humor. But when it works, it's just a beautiful thing, and I feel like we've done a lot to try to make improv accessible to our audience and enjoyable. I mean, I was very proud that we did a long form thing. We did an improvised play, which audience usually long form improv, people who don't know what improv is, or they're not really into sort of experimental theater, or they're not really, you know, most people, your average person is not going to have any context for that, no experience with it, because I wouldn't have when I first even learned that there was such a thing as improv. And for most audiences, they just look at it like a cow looking at a new gate. You know, they don't know what they're seeing. So I was very proud that we were able to take a lot of the concepts and a lot of the things that are beautiful and enjoyable about doing long form, and we put it in a form that people could get, people could understand. We put it like in a science fiction 1 hour play, like a space opera, and everybody instantly understood who these characters are and what they're doing.
And what is that called?
It was called Commander Biff and the GlaxCon Encounter. Which
I think there's a link out now that we'll put in the comments section.
I think there's some videos of us doing that, mm-hmm. and I was so proud of us doing that. We developed that in a year. I mean, we started with the seed idea and we started experimenting with a little bit over a year, and then like before we put it on, we drilled like really hard for, you know, 2 or 3 months, and I could not be more proud of what we did, and I could not be more proud of what the other people in the troop did, and just the way audiences received it. It was beautiful. I mean, I was really happy to be involved in something like that.
So how did doing improv lead to you doing podcasts?
It did not. There was no straight line between those two things. But
so how did that come about?
Well, I became a listener to podcasts and a fan of podcasts. Well, I always liked radio. I mean, I always liked radio. I love radio, and radio in this area basically sucks. Yeah. I mean, it pretty much does. I mean, it just, there's not a lot out there. You got public radio,
and that's
mostly what I listen to in the car. Mm-hmm. So you've got that, and then you've got some. And most of talk radio is going to be political, mm-hmm. and then, you know, and then
or
everything
religious.
Else. Yeah, we're religious, and then everything else is. Basically cookie cutter music stations. I mean, there's like a bluegrass station that's pretty good, but I can't always pick it up. But then other than that, it's just kind of like, it's a wasteland. So when I was doing that job that almost drove me insane, I was in an office and I had time to listen to stuff, because I'm in this office and I'm working with numbers, and I could work on numbers and then also listen to something without getting confused. So I started listening to all these podcasts. So then I got the idea, hey, I could do one of those. So I did a podcast with a friend of mine, with Trevor Britton again, Trevor Britton. I'm going to mention Trevor Britton every 10 minutes in this conversation. It's his anniversary today, by the way.
Oh, happy anniversary to you, Trevor.
Yeah, he and his wife, Jen.
We will be interviewing Trevor at some point once I
can. Did you get him?
Not yet.
Okay.
I'm working on it.
He's a get. It's hard to get. So we did a thing called Ramblin' the podcast, because most podcasts that I was here to at that
oh,
time.
Oh wait, I was like, was that what it was called?
Yeah.
Ramble the colon.
Yeah, Ramblin' colon the podcast. That's the official title. We always just call it the Ramblin' podcast.
The sign colon,
yeah,
not the body
yeah,
part.
Yeah, not the body part. Anyhow, so most of the podcasts that I heard there's some that are really good. But a lot of them fit into this two dudes in a room genre. Two dudes yucking it up in a room. So I said, let's be different and let's be two dudes in a car. So we'd be in a car and we drive places and we go into places. And that got to be a lot of work. Like to figure out every 2 weeks we got to figure out where we're going to go. And we ran out of places to go and we ran out of interesting things to do. And I had to edit the thing, and so we'd record like 2 hours worth of stuff, and then I'd have to turn it into like 45 minutes or an hour, and it's a lot of work. And I get very tired easily, and I'm busy. You know, I have a family and I have a job, so I just quit doing it. So I didn't want to do another podcast, and then I started doing this thing where I would talk to people, like I would just. Ask people to send me their phone numbers, and I say I'll just call you and we'll just talk, like people, like it's preferably people who I don't know. This would be like on Twitter, like I'd say, hey, direct message me your phone number and I'll call you. So I did that a few times, and I talked to people all over the country and just had these interesting conversations. So I was like, you know what, this might be neat just to tape these, just to record, not tape, except I'm showing my age, to digitally record these. And so I put out the call, said, look, I'm going to start recording some of these. And would anybody be interested in that? So I did a thing called Jason Sims is Calling You, which consisted of me having 30-minute conversations with sometimes people I knew, sometimes people I didn't know, and with no agenda. We're just going to start talking on the phone, and after 30 minutes, we'll say goodbye, and that's it. So I did that for a little while, and that was fun. But again, that got to be work, and that got to be tiring. And just, like, the timing of it, like, finding people, you know, I had a friend named Noah Jacobs who was helping me set these calls up, and then there were technical issues. That's what frustrated me with that, was there were technical issues. I never get the thing to sound like what I wanted it to sound like. All kinds of stuff. So I quit doing it. So then I had a friend who's named Dan. Oh, I'm blanking on his name. I'm so sorry,
just
Dan.
Just call him Dan.
No, he has a name. Dan, you don't edit these things, do you?
No.
Oh, no. Dan Pritchard. I remembered your name, Dan. Dan Pritchard, who lives in Australia.
Wow.
He lives in New South Wales, in Orange, Australia, which is geographically almost as far away as you could possibly be from where we're sitting right now.
But that's pretty impressive that you remember where he's from.
Oh, yeah. Well, his name's Dan Pritchard. Dan Pritchard. So
Dan, yeah. He loves you.
I do love you, Dan. So he was wanting to do a podcast network thing, and he asked me if I had any ideas for one. I said, well, I don't want to do... My theory about a lot of things is, if I can't think of a reason why this thing needs to exist, I don't want to do it. Mm-hmm. There are too many podcasts. I don't think I have anything that I could do that someone else can do better. So I started thinking about what could I do? And then I realized I was interested in place. Because you notice how specific I was about where I was born and then where I grew up.
Yes.
I don't know why, but place is the thing. Like, I'm always interested about where people are from and where they grew up and what they did as a kid. Like, anybody who I'm interested in creatively or as a person, that's the stuff I want to know about them. And so I decided that I would like to talk with creative people about how the places they have lived and the places they visited and those and the things that they did there during their formative years, you know, in a lot of cases, how that affects them and their work. So when I decided that I had that idea, I said, okay, I'll do this. So Dan basically does everything that isn't me talking into the microphone. I mean, we both do scheduling, and also my friend, again, Noah Jacobs has helped with some of that and helped with some things. And I've had some friends guest host episodes come on from all around the country and the world guest host. It's just been wonderful. Got to talk to some people who I really, really admire.
And so what was this particular podcast? Was it still?
No, this is different. This is called Jason Sims Puts You in Your Place, which is technically still going. Again, I'm not happy with the sound. So we're working on improving that, and I'm kind of in a holding pattern. I've got some technical issues I'm trying to work out. So the last episode there hasn't been an episode produced yet this year. The last ones were in December, which it was a year old. I mean, I've done it for a year, which for me is a long time because I'm a quitter generally by nature. So
not a quitter. You're an improviser, and improvisers like to keep things fresh.
I'm like I'm a kitten. Like, I will bat at a piece of yarn until I see something else in the corner of my eye, and then I will jump on that. So I'm basically a kitten. But,
okay.
No, so it's called Jason Sims Puts You in Your Place, and if someone who's watching this video was so inclined, they could go to iTunes, and they could subscribe to that, and they could go, or they could go to sliceglobal.com, which is the podcast network, and click the podcast tab, and they can find that. And there's other podcasts there. See, Dan, I forgot your name, but I got the plug. It's sliceglobal.com.
Can you spell that for all those
yeah,
other people?
SLICEGLOBAL.com.
Okay.
No colons.
I know for some of us it's hard to break from that southern accent.
Slice Global.
So you're still working on those and hope to do more of those in the future.
Yeah, we're either going to continue with that or we're going to do something broader. Mm-hmm. Still very much, still involving that idea a lot, but I've got some other ideas that some things I'd like to mix in.
We're not going
to
tell about them yet because...
No, I don't know them yet.
You don't know them
yet. It may continue being just what it is, and there's other things happening that I cannot talk about.
That's so awesome.
Or that I won't talk about. But they're not big. I'm going to act like they're big.
Yeah.
Here's what I'm going to say. There are things happening that I can't talk about. And I'm going to take a sip.
So, as a result of doing your podcast, like you said, you've met a lot of interesting people.
Yes.
Has that helped you travel any yourself? Or
Yeah, I mean, well...
Have you gotten any Have you gone and traveled and met people, that kind of thing?
Yeah, one of the appeals to me of doing the podcast was that I haven't been very many places. I mean, basically, I've been places around the South, and I went to Italy once, and that's basically was it. So it actually wasn't completely involved with the podcast. There was a radio program that until recently was produced at WFMU in New Jersey, but it was broadcast on the internet around the world and broadcast in New York City and things like that. It was a freeform radio station, but there was a show called The Best Show in WFMU, which was hosted by a man named Tom Sharpling, who was a television writer and filmmaker. He was an executive producer on that television show Monk, which is where most people who don't know him from the comedy world and The Best Show, they know him from that. So, and anyway, so there's a sort of a community around that show, people who listen to it, and most people who listen to the show that I've come in contact with are just delightful, creative, warm people, because it's kind of that vibe that's put out by the show. And there's a certain amount of patience. The way the thing is paced, there's a certain amount of patience. The 3-hour show, and he did it for 13 years. So it's like, there's the pacing to it. The kind of person who can make it to get into it, they kind of tend to be of a patient nature and a very sort of easygoing nature. So, excuse me. That show was coming to an end, and over the years I had become a regular caller to that show and sort of involved very distantly. And Tom had invited us to come up to see it and, to be on the show. And so it was getting toward where it's going to end. So a lot of people in that community basically sent us to New York City and, Jersey City, which is right across there. And there were people we stayed with up there. I mean, these people basically just brought us up there. And it was just a wonderful experience. I mean, I really, really enjoyed New York City. I really, really miss New York City. Not right now, because it's apparently covered in snow. but
it has that effect on people, yeah. Honestly. I've been twice.
There's
nothing like it. So you go, if you've never been, you should go to New York City.
Go to New York City sometime, people. Yeah. I don't know if you've heard of this place called New York City.
It's fantastic.
Yeah, but it's like no other place I've been. And it's just, if you're interested in things, there's an awful lot of stuff there to be interested in. And if you're a creative person, I mean, in talking to people for Jason Says Put You in Your Place, New York City is one of those places that constantly comes up because so many creative people either go there or a lot of people are from there. And it's just, as a creative person, down here in a place like Huntsville, which is not an arts town, there are arts here, but it's not an arts town. It's not an arts-oriented town. It's a
space town.
Space and army and engineering and science and
that kind of thing.
That kind of stuff. So, it's really hard to get anything going. It's hard. Like, it's even hard just to find a venue to do something in that's not going to be outrageously expensive. Mm-hmm. Or it's hard to find other people who have the interest or the skills to get together and do things with. And a place like New York City is, you just have the awareness that this is happening
everywhere, all the time.
There's shows going on. I mean, when we were up there, a friend of ours was doing a sketch show at the Pit, People's Improv Theater, and we were able just to go see it. It's just one wonderful experience, and again, I am so grateful to my friends, who basically brought us up there. And I mean, we stayed in people's homes. Like, people gave us their beds. They're like, here, stay in this. I mean, it's just crazy.
It is insane.
I mean, it's wonderful. And it just shows you that these people are just, they're good people everywhere, and they're
just
people.
Just have to find them.
Just have to find, you have to attract them.
Yes.
You have to. So that was really great. I mean, that was a wonderful experience. And the only thing I'm disappointed is I didn't get to see any rats.
Oh, I'd be happy about that. I do not want to
have any interaction with the rat, but I just want to say that I saw like a dog-sized rat. I mean, it would be a cool thought from a distance. Like, I wanted to see it from the safety of a subway car.
Oh my gosh, no.
That would be, or at least like a swarm, like Like, I'm walking across a bridge, and like, from a safe distance, I see a swarm of, like, 10,000 rats, like knock over a car or something. I mean, that would have been what I would want to see. But I did not see that. But other than that, New York was exactly as advertised.
So are there any other things that have come from your improv or your podcast that you've been able to do?
Well, I mean, I think the muscles that we exercise in the improv, it's affected all my other creative endeavors. I mean, the ability to quickly develop an idea, the confidence. I'll tell you what, I mean, seriously, I mean, I am a, you know, I'm a middle-aged, you know, overweight guy. I'm not the most graceful person, and so I mean, there's a certain degree of self-consciousness that can go with that. And when I first started performing, doing improv, that the hardest thing as always for me was my what to do with my body, what to do with this thing, and because I'm not an action-oriented person, I'm a sit quietly and think about things oriented person, or sit quietly or sit and talk person. So being on a stage necessitated me becoming more being able to do movement and use my body to create characters and to just not be annoying to look at. But anyway, having done that and know that I can go on a stage in front of people, and they enjoy what you do. I mean, that has given me a lot of confidence I didn't have before. And another thing about doing the podcast, along with that, as far as confidence goes, is I talk to these people, having interacted with people whose work that I admire, I mean, and get to have conversations with them, and even not just on the podcast, but just sort of socially interact with people who I would consider myself to be a fan of, hearing their stories, just realizing that they're just people. Like, they don't build them in some factory somewhere where they make talented people, and they don't just, like, you know, come off some assembly line. No, they were like a kid somewhere, and they were some guy that was interested in something the same way I'm interested in things, and they just started doing it, and then due to, like, talent, you know, combination of talent, hard work, relationships, and chance, they ended up getting to do the thing that they love to do at a level where they're able to make a living and be admired by people who don't even know them, like me. That's how I would, you know, see them. And to realize that there's no difference in nature between those people and me, that has been, and it's something that you just know, but to take possession of that knowledge, to really, like, for it to become real to you, mm-hmm. that's been very, that's increased my confidence and motivation and hope, because from here it's just hard to get anything going from here. Mm-hmm. But that's changed. I mean, the internet has changed. Like, this thing right here, I mean, you know, 20 years ago, this would have just been you just have people come over to your house and force them to watch this. But now you'll email them and force them to watch it.
Yes, I'll annoy them until they watch it.
But potentially anybody in the world could, some guy in Zimbabwe could accidentally click on this link and, yeah. Hello, Zimbabwe. And they could be watching it. And so, I mean, the internet has, I mean, the fact that I know the people that I know is through the internet. A lot of the you know, people who I have my conversations with, I do it through Skype. I mean, it's the internet. So, I mean, that kind of has lessened the tyranny of geography in a way.
Yeah. Yeah. In another interview that I did for this playlist, we talked a little bit about that and how mm-hmm. It was a friend of mine, Charlie White, who I interviewed. He makes films, mm-hmm. and he started out back in the 90s when the internet was just starting. So we talked a little bit about that in that podcast, how you used to go to the movies because the video wasn't going to come out until 9 months later, mm-hmm. or 12 months later, mm-hmm. and it was going to come out on VHS, so the quality wasn't as good as what you saw in the movie theater.
And you were going to have it on this TV that was
little at best.
like that, but still square and
right. It wasn't just gonna work like you would see in the movie. So people would pay $5-$10 to go to the movies at the most $10. But now how that's changed, and that's interesting that you brought up that point as well, because it is true. People can see this all over the world.
Yeah, and there's a good and a bad, because the good is, we're able to do these things that we never would have been able to do. But the bad is now that the signal to noise ratio is a lot higher. There's a lot more noise.
Yeah.
I mean, it's like everybody can do this. Like kids with an iPhone can shoot and edit and produce video that's better than what we could have done with
prosumer equipment. I saw an Apple commercial today.
Yeah.
That they filmed with 24 iPhones, I think.
Mm-hmm. I read about that.
They used a good number of iPhones, mm-hmm. and they made a commercial. And, you know, it's crazy the way that technology has developed and changed the way things are.
Well, I know a couple, they shot a music video, like a for real music video, using a couple iPhones with these attachments where you can attach Canon lenses to them. And it just looks great. It just looks amazing. But the thing is that these kids can carry this stuff in their hands that you would have had to have a whole room full of equipment to do.
Yeah.
So the thing is, you know, to me, the trick is how do you get, you know, how do you get seen in the haze? Like, how do you break through that
big
fog?
How do you get to be the big fish in the big...
I don't know that the ponds are going to be big anymore. Maybe there'll be a lot of those smaller ponds. Maybe. But at least we'll have water.
Yeah, this is true.
We won't be on the... side of the pond. And I'm happy with that, because what I want, I mean, this stuff that I do, I'm going to do it because I'm wired to do it, and my brain will not let me not do it, and it's going to do it anyway no matter what I do. So if I was able just to make, to be able to eat and have a roof
this
over my
is
head.
Very important to you and I both,
yeah.
Right?
Oh, yeah.
Eating
yeah.
is important.
I have a habit. eating habit. But, no, if I was able to just have a modest living and be able to do that, I would be overjoyed. Like, I am not looking to be super famous or looking to...
It's highly have overrated. A giant,
yeah. Well, believe me, it's... let me tell you about fame. It's highly overrated. No, I mean... No, I don't care. I mean, I really don't care. I mean, if I was just able to do this kind of work and be able to eat, I would be overjoyed. And I think that is becoming more possible for more people.
Mm-hmm.
You know, maybe less people will be gigantic, you know, huge stars or whatever, but that's might be good.
I know from my perspective as a creative person and an artist, coming from where you and I both come from, because I'm from North Alabama mm-hmm. as well. I was born and raised here. Until things were opened up, because I went to a very, the school that I went to was more athletic based,
mm-hmm.
you know, and
I think
so,
that's
you know,
very common in this area.
In this area, yeah. It's common for that to be, because you have Roll Tide, Alabama,
right
down the road here, about 3 hours away or something like that.
In our hearts.
In our hearts.
Right here in
it's
our
right
hearts.
Here. But anyway, you know, there wasn't that big creative push. I mean, we didn't learn about these things that you and I have learned as mm-hmm. things have opened up here in the area we live in. And how does that, I know with me, I have my own thoughts about that.
Mm-hmm.
And how does that, what do you think about that as far as the way you grew up and then having the exposure now and everything being so open, how has that changed things for you, I guess is the question.
When I look back at me and I look at my surroundings, I look at my parents or I look at my family, and I look at my peers, I cannot account for myself. Like, I don't know what happened. Something happened. Something went either terribly wrong or terribly right. But something just went weird. Like, what I like to tell people, I'm 33% my mother and 33% my father, and I'm 33% other materials with the 1% like argon or something. But no, I mean, because... there literally is a big swath of my personality and interests that have no analog in my surroundings or my family or whatever. So I feel like I always sought out things that are easily accessible now. Like, I just had this nature where I would just seek out the unusual.
And it had to be that way because of where we live, right?
Right. And I guess if we hadn't have been that way, we wouldn't have already been interested in this kind of stuff and trying to do this kind of stuff. So now it's just like, on the one hand, I'm just like, oh, these friggin' kids, they're so easy for them. You know, it's just like, excuse me, like some kid can find out that there was such a thing, for example. So a kid could find out that there's such a thing as punk rock, for example. And then by this afternoon, he can have everything from, like, you know, the Sex Pistols to Black Flag to everything. Like, he could just have that, like, right now. Like, he could just have it all on his iPod, and he could be burned out on it in a month. Whereas, when I found out about a thing called punk rock, not that this is the highest and most noble calling or, you know, high art, but just to say, when I found out about that when I was in a band or whatever, we would just, like anything, it was hard to get your hands on things. You know, you'd have to, like, go to a record store or or order something, and you'd get this, you know, get this record or this tape, and you just listen to it, and you'd, like, scan the liner notes trying to figure out, like, you're looking for signs or something, because you couldn't find out much, you know, you could only find out so much about these people. It wasn't this constant, you couldn't tweet at them. Like, I couldn't tweet at some guy in some band I was listening to and ask him a question. So
it seems so far removed.
Right, it seems so distant, and I think for maybe people now, is it doesn't seem distant. Like, you know, reality television has taken us into, you know, a fake version of celebrities' lives. I mean, I think a highly produced, highly orchestrated, but a celebrity's life probably is highly produced and highly orchestrated. So, I mean, things like Twitter and, like, you know, and people's, what's the thing, the Instagram. Like, you know, some famous person can have an Instagram, you just, like, see their dog, and you, like, see it, you know. Like, it's just weird. Like, the people are not, there's not this distance anymore.
We've seen them. Would you say it's almost we've seen the man behind the curtain?
Maybe, in a way. And this is a roundabout way to talk about this, but I was watching the early Saturday Night Lives. And so, like, you know, first season, second season. And so, like, a lot of, and my favorite thing, one of my favorite things of Saturday Night Live has always been the commercial parodies. I think the commercial parodies are usually just great. And I was watching the early commercial parodies, and some of them weren't that funny. And I was like, the thing was that they were making a, what was the joke was that they were making a fake commercial. It didn't have to be that funny. It's like, we know how to make a commercial, because the generation that created Saturday Night Live, they were the generation that grew up with television, and they understood it in a way that previous generations didn't understand it. They got the tricks. They understood the manipulations that you did in advertising, so they could make fake stuff. Well, now I think kids coming up now, they just understand all of this stuff, so they can make movies. They can make, I mean, they make parody. I mean, it's very common for kids to make parodies of things that are
YouTube
very
videos.
Yeah, or that are, or things in the culture that are very, you know, observant and very well capture a thing, or, you know, make these little macro pictures of cat, you know, lolcats or whatever, yeah. Or boss, what do they call them, boss animals?
Yeah.
I'm so old.
Me too.
With, you know, the text on them, that they understand how things are made, because they have all, there's really no tool. I mean, the only tools that the kids don't have access to are just the things that, like, Peter Jackson would have. Just
money.
Because it's money.
Money.
But basically, my son, both of my kids can sit down and use a 3D modeling program called Unity, which is free, and they can make 3D objects. And if they really, really wanted to, they could make a game. I mean, there's other free software that they could channel that, and they could create a game if they had the time and
it goes with
and
that
energy.
Way with music, records, CDs,
right. I mean,
whatever.
Yeah, I mean, so the thing is it's not a mysterious, like, a CD used to be this mysterious object. Like, how do they get this on there? You know, not just anybody could make a CD, not just anybody could make a multi-track recording, not just anybody could make a video, you know, but now just anybody can. So it's kind of demystified, and I don't know if that's, you know, I don't know if that makes us lose a sense of wonder, or if the wonder is now going to have to come from the ideas and come from the performances, because that's the one thing that even though everybody can have access to a camera, not everybody can be Robert Duvall.
No.
You know?
Absolutely.
So, I mean, whoa, did you feel that? It was like a time shift. There's like a, I think there was a disturbance in the space-time continuum.
What was
strange.
That? Lost in space. Hey. Well, the tea is gone.
Almost out of tea.
And it is time to say goodbye to Mr. Jason Sims. Yeah. Thank you for coming by
with
me today.
I will come by and drink your tea anytime.
We'll have you over again. Maybe you'll have to drag Mr. Britton over, and we'll do a tag team session with both of you.
you know, it's good for you, Trevor. I'm very intimidated.
Thank you again.
Oh, yeah, thank
I really
you.
Appreciate it.
Manny, you're a very good friend, and I'm taller than you.
Well, isn't everyone?
I wanted to say two facts. Goodbye. I don't know what that means.